So I had already the material from a paper I had published on response assemblages, which is my first attempt to apply, to develop a methodology to using assemblage thinking to address a very practical problem, which has to do with how to assess the effectiveness of policies. Assemblage thinking makes a difference. First of all, we have to conceptualize human responses to environmental degradation, which is a broader topic. So I developed a conceptual approach at the base of which, on the basis of which, I developed the assessment methodology, and then I'll sum up some of the main conclusions. Now, human responses to environmental degradation are usually human responses. Now I have to sit. Human responses to environmental degradation are usually narrowly conceived as specific response option instruments, language practices, policy instruments, which target either the resources impacted or the drivers of degradation, and also they focus on best practices. A broader conception is that human response to degradation is whatever people do in a degraded area, because they may not perceive degradation, so it's just what they do. So they are better conceived as the products of decisions regarding the utilization of resources to meet individual or and/or collective goals emerging from dynamic multi-level interactions among the components of complex message socio-ecological systems, or better, socio-ecological milieu, as I will use from now on. So a response assembly is a geographically and historically unique, provisional, open, territorial whole, a complex composition emerging from processes of assembling biophysical and human components that include specific response options from an affected focal and other socio-ecological milieus to serve human goals. The existence, however brief, of a response assembly means that an acceptable degree of match fit among its components exists that serves the purpose of its constitution, which may or may not include combating degradation. This is what I define as the socio-ecological fit of the response assembly. The policy question, a common policy question, is what is the effectiveness of human responses to environmental degradation in the sense of combating degradation and promoting sustainable development? And the criterion, based on the literature and common sense, is the maintenance of socio-ecological resilience of the response assembly. The maintenance of socio-ecological resilience, but I claim that we have to focus on the response assembly. So, SEFRA, socio-ecological fit of the response assembly, can measure the effectiveness of human responses, in other words, the degree to which the associations among the components preserve its ecological, socio-ecological resilience, and the question is how to assess the socio-ecological fit. I have developed a conceptual approach which tries to bridge assemblage thinking, assuming that this is the correct ontology, and resilient thinking, which deals with dynamics of change. Both have common analytical orientation because they use the resources for the analysis of complex systems. From the point of view of assemblage thinking, socio-ecological milieus are conceptualized as multiplicities constituted by response assemblages, individual singularities according to Manuel. And they have a style of structuration which include their composition, heterogeneous, relatively autonomous components linked by a relationship to exteriority, and the process of the vast territorialization, deterritorialization, and coding and recording is omitted. Now, I will show you a very schematic representation of a response assemblage which is designed for the purposes of studying responses to degradation. This is why I have isolated responses which are a component of the human system, but I have isolated them to show the interaction shows of the biophysical system, climate, soil, water, vegetation, land cover, etc. The human system, economy, economic structure, financial resources, technology, physical infrastructure, land use, capital, land use, settlement, and society, population, human resources, social structure and social capital, cultural institution, politics, which perform the biophysical system performs ecological function, critical ecological function, and the human system also. The biophysical system produces ecosystem services, the human system produces human services. So here responses produce impacts that impact on the function, the critical function, modify the system. Biophysical and the human system, modify the services provided, which induce changes in responses and so on. This is a simplification, as also I have simplified the focal level, which is given when we study an area, we study a given area, so it is the focal system. And the levels, the higher levels, which from the assembly point of view, they are not pre-given. They emerge. There is nothing written on language. It says original level. We define what is the original level, and so on. So now, response assemblages to properties which emerge from the contextual and contingent complex interactions among their components. The critical components are those that are associated with the critical biophysical and human function. They have thresholds, for example, the circulation of various materials, original energy exchanges, and so on, which are very critical for the preservation of the systems, and the same holds true for the human system. Components possess capacities that are unpredictable. The capacities and thresholds of critical components that engage in processes which either produce or reduce environmental degradation explain the emergence of the response assemblages. And the possibility space of a response assembly, following Manuel's very clear description of assembly thinking, comprise the set of possible capacities of critical components. Now, what I have to say is that over time, critical components may change. They are not fixed over time. The basin of attraction is a region within the possibility space, which is organized around an attractor, and complex socio-ecological milieus possess a complex distribution of attractors and multidimensional basis of attraction, which can be considered as the locus of assemblage of the population of response assemblages which emerge from different combinations of existing and new components that exercise their capacities in particular historical context. This is a very schematic presentation of a basin of attraction adapted from Walker, who is one of the well-known researchers in resilience thinking, which shows its characteristic geometry, the latitude, the width of the basin, its resistance, the topology of the basin, which shows the ease or difficulty which the system can carry, the precariousness, which shows the assemblage, how close it is to a critical threshold, and finally, which has to do with the influence of higher and lower levels on a focal level. So a response assemblage is a point, a state in the basin of attraction, and it represents adaptations of the focal Millet, who changed in the magnitude, influence and importance of slow and fast variables. This is a distinction which has been questioned. What is slow, what is fast? But variables change in different speeds, so some are very slow, like calcium, for example, or some are very fast, like prices or temperatures. If thresholds associated with a critical component like soil depth, population size, sociocultural acceptance are crossed, then the system moves to a different basin populated by different response assemblages. Emergent response assemblages possess agency because they act back on their components, either constraining their relationship, thus maintaining their identity, as it is reflected, for example, in persisting land use patterns and dominant human responses, or enable their transformation. The agency and identity of response assemblages in assemblage thinking perspective is composite and distributive, due to their style of structuration, several components which interact. Now, when human responses are conceptualized as response assemblies, then the question is how effectively to maintain the socio-ecological resilience in a study area, then the socio-ecological pit of the response assembly, construed as a fit for purpose sense, expresses the degree to which the style of structuration of the response assembly promotes the preservation of the socio-ecological resilience in a period. The determinant of the fit rests with the capacities and thresholds of the assembly components and the recurrent process of assembly. The relative autonomy of the components of the response assembly and their contingently obligatory relationships implies that the existence and degree of fit is also contextual and contingent. So the fit is emergent, distributive and composite trait of the response assembly with non-linear and uncertain causal structure. Now, resilient thinking has developed a theory of dynamics of change, which says that the dynamics of change in a socio-ecological milieu is controlled by three system-level properties: resilience, adaptability, and transformability, that together determine its socio-ecological resilience. In other words, its capacity to respond to disturbances and reorganize while undergoing change so as to preserve its identity, structure, critical functions, and feedbacks in ways that do not foreclose future development options. Socio-ecological resilience is a hyper-property of a response assembly. Now, here are the definitions of resilience, adaptability, and transformability according to the resilience thinking group. And what is important is that they are defined as capacity. So they can be considered, this is my suggestion, as a reduced form of the multidimensional possibility space of a response assembly, the set of capacities of the critical components that constrain the repertoire of land use patterns and human responses that materialize in the field. However, resilience, adaptability, and transformability system-level properties are not known a priori with certainty, but they are revealed from the values of lower-level properties of the response assembly, in other words, from place and time-specific interactions among and within its components, especially the critical ones. LLPs, the lower-level properties, concern the morphology, functioning, and output of the response assembly, and they can be assessed on the basis of the characteristics of the human and biophysical system. Most important, according to the literature, in some order of priority, is potential available for change, amount of resources, robustness, diversity, redundancy, connectedness, modularity, and openness. Here are the definitions from the literature. So the rationale of the conceptual approach is that human responses produce changes in the components of human and biophysical system, which cause impacts, which modify the properties of the system, the lower level properties, and the system liver pleurotrophy. So eventually they modified the resilience of the system. So at this point, if this is ecological resilience is above a certain level, according to some decision makers, then the fit of the response assembly is considered acceptable and the responses and the current assembly persist. If socio-ecological resilience is below an acceptable level, then the fit is considered not acceptable. And here we have two directions of two types of decision. One is that no action is taken or negative responses follow, thresholds are crossed, and we may go to a degraded response assemblage, or the current response assemblage may be modified and its components and their relationships, so human responses are modified, which may produce an acceptable level of socio-ecological resilience. On the basis of this conceptual approach, I have developed a four-stage methodology, which starts from a general description of the whole study area and the hierarchy, a more detailed description of the evolution of the milieu and the description of phases, an analytical stage where we assess socio-ecological resilience, and the stage of decision if we can experiment with alternative response assemblages. The first stage relies on thick description of the study area. We do whatever pieces of information we have, a rich storyline is essential, in order to come up with an idea of the geometry of the basin or basins of attraction over the study period, the critical values and thresholds. The second stage is to identify stages in the evolution of the system. Within each stage, to identify the response assemblages, the ranges of the components, the thresholds, the processes of assembly, by the physical and socioeconomic processes, to assess relationships among components and impacts. So, in other words, in this stage, we determine what is the place of the response assemblage in the basin of attraction, and we can assess the overall resilience, the drivers and identify the drivers and proximate causes of change, and explain the emergence of response assemblage where explanation is both qualitative and quantitative. I'm not going to go through stage 3, but stage 3 starts from the assessment of lower level properties. For example, what is the potential, the natural capital of an area. So, using several techniques from the natural sciences, we can assess the amount of water resources, soil, etc., etc. And on this basis, you can assess all lower level properties, or most of them. Then we combine them to assess resilience, adaptability, and transformability. Transformability is assessed only if it makes sense, only if you have historical information that a threshold has been crossed, so the system has moved to, has undergone a transformation. If no transformation has occurred, transformability is not assessed. So then all the assessments are combined into an overall assessment of socio-ecological resilience, which is evaluated to see if it is fit or not, and then we provide explanation. I shall show you a matrix which combines the assessment of the lower level properties, but I have to tell you the final stage, which addresses the question how can improve the socio-ecological resilience of the system of a response assembly. The question is that we cannot find the golden rule, but we can experiment with changes in components and the relationships of the assemblies in order to see if an optimal response assembly will emerge. We cannot know it a priori. Now, this is a matrix which shows the lower level properties and which are assessed for each component of the biophysical, economic and social system. The assessment is diverse, depending on what is the component and what kind of data we have. Now, here is an important row which shows to which characteristic of the geometry of the basin of attraction each property corresponds. For example, the potential of a response assembly, the amount of resources, corresponds to the latitude of the basin. If we have many resources, the basin is broad and can accept changes without the response assembly leaving the system. If it is narrow, the system may be found in a very precarious condition and move to another point. Robustness also is related to the resistance, how easy it is to modify the response assembly. Redundancy has to do with precariousness. If we have redundancy, several options, several resources, types of resources, we can stay in the same basin of attraction, otherwise we move to another. Diversity has to do with latitude and resistance, connectedness with panarchy, how connected is the system internally and externally. Modularity is a very important, but not very much research property of the system. It has to do with the latitude of the basin and its resistance. And openness has to do with the latitude, resistance and panarchy. So we have assessments. This is what I call a normalized matrix, because the assessments are expressed in different units. So somehow we have to normalize them. There are several ways to normalize the matrix. We show the relative importance of each component for each property. These assessments are then evaluated according to criteria. I suggest that we use the properties of the system as criteria and not externally defined criteria to, on the basis of scientific evidence. For example, soil scientists tell us that if soil depth is below 5 centimeters, then the system is very precarious. It will undergo, it will degrade your the slope. So depending on the component, we evaluate each assessment of each property for each component. So again, we come up with a matrix which shows which components are most important for which properties, which have to do with the characteristics of the basin of attraction. So we come up with a composite and distributed assessment of the fit. We know not exactly, but we know well what are the critical components and which of their properties. So we have a better basis, in my opinion, to proceed to changes and experimentation in order to come up with the possibility of optimal response assembly. So, I sum up. The novelty and the value of assembly-based approaches is that assembly thinking provides the indispensable ontological foundation for the analysis and gathering of a real-world complex socio-ecological milieu that are neither seamless holes nor networks, but multiplicity comprising assembly. Now, their formation and place are explained by recorded dynamic multi-level biophysical and societal processes that signal how people have provisionally used biophysical and human resources to meet their needs and or chosen to respond to environmental degradation. Because assemblage embodies the notion of fit for purpose, it constitutes the proper integrated basis for the comprehensive treatment of the socio-ecological fit that is all-inclusive and broader than the original version of fit between ecosystem and institution. This is where the whole discussion started, which is very narrow. because it treats institutions as components of the assemblage and not as separate from the Pope Ellenbroger sociological milieu, and examines the role and the relationships among all components without privileging the ecological, environmental ones and environmental policies and institutions, or narrowly focusing on some socioeconomic issues. The socioecological fit is always tied to a response assemblage because actors with different knowledge, perception of degradation, values, priority, assess it differently. Lasting response assemblages and persistent human responses may owe to powerful, privileged, and influential actors that find them highly fit, although not necessarily beneficial. The conceptual approach I have proposed is that it offers a rationale to link the style of structuration of a response assemblage and its changes to changes in lower level properties, system level properties, resilience, and eventually the fit. That helps explain the dynamics of change of a socio-ecological milieu as a function of changes in the response assemblages which emerge over time and support the integrated assessment of the fit. The proposed methodology emphasizes the formation of the assemblages rather than stages or phases like the adaptive cycle of Holland. The role and importance and the relationships among components is not assumed constant over time, but contextual and contingent, depending on the emergent response assemblages and their fit. The methodology places emphasis on the lower level properties that result from and thus better reflect interactions among components rather than on the characteristics of the individual component, for example, the slope or temperature or whatever. These are isolated characteristics. The properties reflect relationships. So the contextuality and contingency of the system. The assessment of the fit is provisional, distributed, and composite, and thresholds of critical components may limit the fit, in particular assemblages. It accommodates different scientific and actor perspectives and handles present and future uncertainty, and directs decision and policy making to experiment with interventions to modify the assemblage components and processes of assembly to support the emergence of response assemblages, or to affect the transition to other basins of attraction to secure the resilience of the milieu. Now, this approach offers a new outlook on decision and policy guidance because institutions are components of the assemblages. Policy formulation and implementation and management are processes of assembly that, together with non-policy processes, explain the emergence of response assemblages. So decision-making is immanent to the response assembly, implying that socio-ecological fit solution to degradation can be achieved not exclusively via interventions on environmental resources by environmental institutions, but also, and perhaps more often, via interventions on any component and process of assembly that modify either the geometry of the basin of attraction and or the place of the system within. Best practices and one-size-fits-all solutions are replaced by the search for provisional consensus optimal response assemblages that a majority of actors finds fit to preserve socio-ecological resilience under alternative scenarios. And the role of adaptive co-management is to experiment with mechanisms to coordinate new and old policies to encourage the emergence of optimal research response assemblages. The challenges for future research are limitless, but let us see a few of them. The reconceptualization of human responses and their fit means that theoretically integrated assessment methodology requires the creative synthesis of diverse quantitative and qualitative techniques and the development of novel approaches to assess all properties and the fit. And empirical studies are needed to assist field development the refinement of techniques and the evaluation of the role of policies in the emergence of both temporary and lasting response assemblies, and will eventually test the value of the methodology. Thank you very much.